the name of Jesus Christ, that he is the Christ and the Son of God, and believing we may have life in his name. All of the miracles in the Gospel of John are specifically to bring us to faith in Jesus Christ. And the turning of the water to wine at this wedding in a little known town called Cana of Galilee was to lead us to faith. You know, before we read of this miracle in chapter 2, in chapter 1, Jesus is introduced to us as the eternal Word of God. He's the uncreated creator. He's the beginning without a beginning. And one thing that John says about Jesus in John chapter 1 and verse 16, it says, "Of his fullness have we all received, and grace upon grace." You ever thought about that? Grace upon grace. The word picture is like a flowing stream. When you look at a flowing stream or a flowing fountain, what are you looking at? You're looking at water pouring out upon water. We're supposed to understand that in the fullness of Jesus Christ, we receive grace upon grace. And at the very beginning, by saying that, John is kind of foreshadowing and creating this frame that Jesus brings us into spiritual abundance, grace upon grace. Like Paul says, where sin has abounded, God's grace has super abounded. You see, John is writing to Gentile readers who, in not knowing God, are living in spiritual scarcity. He's also writing to Jews who, in approaching God just through the form and ceremony of religion, are living in spiritual scarcity. And John is calling everyone to Jesus, where we find spiritual abundance. And then after that, he moves on to talk about Jesus calling his disciples. And he mentions how Jesus called Andrew, and he called his brother Peter. But then there's Philip, and there's Nathaniel. And we read that his disciples were with him as they went to this gathering. They were invited to this wedding, and Jesus has them there to use this as an episode to strengthen their faith. You can look in John chapter 2 and verse 11. You see the outcome of this whole miracle was what? It says his disciples believed in him. So this episode is for the followers of Jesus Christ to strengthen our faith. And I believe that John is picking up that theme, the fullness, the abundance of Christ, and he's strengthening our faith through giving us a picture of the abundance that is found in Christ. The wedding got to a place of scarcity. They did not have enough wine. But Jesus came and not just provided enough wine, but he provided the highest quality, the freshest, most pure juice of the grape. As a matter of fact, at this time, without refrigeration, almost anything that you drank would have a little fermentation to it. So really good wine would be wine that had as little fermentation as possible. So how is it that Jesus was able to give them this juice so fresh, as if they had just plucked the grapes off the vine and squeezed them into the glass themselves? Who is this man? Well, I believe that in this episode, God is inviting us into the spiritual abundance that is found in Jesus. This story helps us to answer the question, how do we as followers of Jesus live in his spiritual abundance? And we'll just take a moment, and I know my time limit, to reflect on this to close our service and think about what did we just do in taking the bread and the wine. You see, you and I, outside of Christ, apart from Jesus, our life is a life of spiritual scarcity, emptiness. We lack. And when we're in this position of lack, sin is very appealing and attractive to us. Am I right? Because temptation convinces us there is something that we need that we don't have, and the only way to find it is in going after that which is outside of God's will. That spiritual scarcity, always seeking something. I'm agitated. I'm not satisfied. I'm not at peace. I'm not at content, and I need something. If you don't understand what I'm saying, think of Eve. Eve was in a place of abundance, of everything in God's garden she could freely eat. But the serpent, the devil, through the serpent, came and convinced her what? No, you're actually in a place of scarcity. God hasn't let you have absolutely everything. Your freedom is conditioned upon obeying God. It's not absolute freedom to do whatever you want. As a matter of fact, God's holding something back from you. And when Eve was convinced that she was actually in a place of spiritual scarcity, it was easy for her to take that fruit that God said, do not eat it, and now seek in it something she felt like she didn't have. It's the reason that God, through the prophet Jeremiah, rebuked his people. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 13, the Lord says, my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed for themselves broken cisterns that can hold no water. Apart from Christ, our life is like a cracked jar. No matter how much you pour into it, it's always leaking and it's always empty. Doesn't matter how much money you pour into it, how much pleasure, doesn't matter how much you earn the respect and admiration of people, you're always going to be empty. That's spiritual scarcity. So the Lord wants to bring us to spiritual abundance. And so we see here, John chapter 2. Now, on the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. And Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no wine left. Now, let's be honest. It's embarrassing for any of us to host an event and to not have enough food. Amen? That would be embarrassing. If we came to the potluck after the service and there's not enough, there's always a shame and embarrassment. Oh, no. You guys didn't make proper preparations. You didn't think ahead. But in this culture, it's much more serious. It's unthinkable that you would host a wedding feast. By the way, this is not your wedding reception that's maybe 4, 5, or 6 hours. This is a wedding reception that could easily last for a week or more. Because when the Jews, when they threw a party, they knew how to party, I guess. That's just the world of that time. Like, we're going to really have a good time and celebrate. But if the host, if the master of the ceremony had not thought ahead and planned wisely to provide, how shameful that was. And so Jesus is even using this to foreshadow himself, because there's a great expectation that has risen about Jesus. This man named John the Baptist has preached Jesus as the bridegroom. He's preached Jesus as the Messiah who has come. How terrible would it be if Jesus was just another Johnny come lately, another false Messiah who rises up, makes big promises, and fails to deliver? How shameful would that be? So I believe Jesus is even using this as an opportunity to say, no, I am the Messiah. I am the Son of God. I will not fail to deliver on the promises I have made. That's important to us, especially in the election season. Every election season, I don't care whoever you think the best president was, none of them have ever lived up to their own hype. But praise God for the Lord Jesus Christ. So Mary, she goes to Jesus, and she's innocent. Jesus, we have a crisis. We have a situation. There's no wine left. And I love what Jesus does. Jesus replied, woman, why are you saying this to me? My time has not yet come. Now, we read that in English, and it almost sounds disrespectful. Woman. You know, if we talk to a woman like that, it's like, woman, why are you asking me this? Now, this is not disrespect. This was the common greeting for a woman, just as if we might say, ma'am. If someone said, pastor, I need your help. Ma'am, I'm not sure if I can help you. That's what it would sound like today. However, you do need to understand, this was not the greeting that a son would give to his mother. Almost always, a son, especially in this time, calls his mother, mother. So when Jesus calls Mary woman or madam or ma'am, he's saying, hey, we have to understand there's a little bit of a changed relationship here. When you read about Jesus as a boy, it says he went home and submitted to his parents. But now that he's been baptized and announced as the Messiah, he has to let her know there's a change dynamic. Instead of a relationship where I'm a son submitting to his mother, you need to understand that you're a disciple submitting to your master. And I love what Jesus does. He doesn't deny her request. He's going to fulfill the need and the request, but he has to do it in such a way that Mary knows the proper dynamic, that he's fulfilling the need as her Lord, and she must submit to him as his disciple. And I believe Mary gets this because in verse 5, his mother told the servants, whatever he tells you, do it. I'll be honest, friends. I'm glad I wasn't one of Jesus' brothers because that would have been a hard example to live up to. He would have always been the good kid. He would have always gotten it right. So I believe by this point, Mary knows Jesus. She's seen his wisdom. She's seen the purity of his life. She just says, you know what, just follow him. He'll get it right. So friends, spiritual abundance. If you want to live in the spiritual abundance of Jesus, the first thing you must know is you have to experience the miracle of surrender. Surrender. God's abundance is an ever-flowing stream, and it's there, it's freely given. But you cannot experience the abundance of the stream if you stubbornly choose to remain on the bank and never actually get in to the overflow. You have to experience the miracle of surrender. So now, the moment has been surrendered to Jesus. The question is, what is Jesus going to do with this moment? Verse 6 says, now there were 6 stone water jars there for Jewish ceremonial washing, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. I believe John brings out this detail as a sign of the old covenant. The old covenant was not bad, but it was limited in its scope and purpose. It was not bad. The old covenant was given by God, but the old covenant could not actually provide salvation, only point us forward to our need of salvation and Jesus who was coming. The old covenant was based on man's efforts and what we could do. And so you have these ceremonial washing jars. Verse 7, Jesus told the servants, fill the water jars with what? With water. Now, if those jars were there for people to ceremoniously wash their hands, what was already in the jar? Water. And if people had been cleansing off their hands, what kind of water was in those jars? It was a dirty water. So implied in Jesus' command is, hey, for this miracle to happen, I first need you to empty out that which is used and defiled and unclean and fill it with fresh water. It's a picture of what Jesus does in us. So they filled them up to the very top. They obeyed Jesus' commands. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the head steward, and they did. When the head steward tasted the water that had been turned to wine, not knowing where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, he called the bridegroom. So what happened? Without even saying anything, just in the process of the servants emptying and filling and now drawing out the water and bringing it to the head steward, somewhere in there, Jesus made that water become wine. It's a picture of what he wants to do in your life, my friends. He wants to empty us of that which is unclean, our sin. He wants to fill us with fresh water, his spirit, his truth, his righteousness. But even above and beyond that, there is the added miracle beyond any human ability that he makes a miraculous transformation. That's what he wants for you. That's what he wants for me. And it gets better because the head steward calls the bridegroom, verse 10, and said to him, everyone serves the good wine first, and then the cheaper wine when the guests have drunk. You have kept the good wine until now. So Jesus wants to empty you. He wants to fill you. He wants to transform you. And in walking with him, he wants to bring you out of that scarcity that says, I don't know what's coming next. I don't know what disappointment's coming next, what failure is coming next, what defeat, what difficulty is coming next. No, Jesus wants you to know that in following him, the blessing he gives today is a promise of an even greater blessing tomorrow. In other words, in Jesus, you can know your next thing will be the best thing in following him. And that helps us know that if we want to experience the spiritual abundance in Jesus Christ, we must also experience the miracle of sanctification. Growth in Christ. I believe that's why Jesus unfolded this miracle the way he did. Our growth requires a continual emptying, a continual filling, a continual transformation, and we can continue in this relationship of sanctification and growth in Christ, not dependent upon our own efforts, but because we know, God, whatever you have next is better. You see, let's break it down. You and I have all sinned. We know what sin is like. Sin glitters like gold, and it promises everything. And it can even be fun for a little while. But if you've ever given yourself to sin and indulged and broken apart from God's word and his will, you know that the end result is death, emptiness, fruitlessness, fear, shame, condemnation. Sin begins to destroy and ruin you internally. And through your influence, sin begins to ruin others externally. We've all tasted that to some lesser or greater degree. That's sin. But Jesus is saying that scarcity, that's life outside of me, in me, even though God calls us to face challenges, even though he calls us to embrace duty, even though he calls us to make sacrifices, the reward we get following is always better. And it gets better the next time and better the next time when you trust Jesus. So you resist temptation now, it's hard, but the reward of peace and the reward of spiritual power is stronger. So you go out to serve Christ now, and it's hard because you're uncomfortable. You don't know how to witness and share with people, but you do your best now, and next time it gets even better and even better. You choose the high road now, and you choose to be loving and sacrificial and forgiving. It's tough, but it gets better each time. Experience the miracle of sanctification. Now, what's the point of all this? In verse 11, it says, Jesus did this as the first of his miraculous signs in Cana of Galilee. In this way, he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. So what's the big idea? Jesus was revealing his glory to his disciples. And what is the glory of God? It's the character of God. He wanted his disciples to understand who he was. See, this miracle of spiritual abundance, friends, it's not just about the fact that Jesus can. There are many things that Jesus can do, and he is powerful, and he can turn water into wine. But Jesus wanted to go a step further and let his disciples then, and all of his disciples now, understand, it's not just that I can turn the water into wine, it's that I want to do that for you. I want you to know that your life is not to be a life of continual defeat and continual drudgery. Your life is to be a life of continual advancement, from one victory unto another. It's a life of joy, knowing that you will face trials, you will make sacrifices, but it gets better and better. And so, if we want to experience the spiritual abundance of Jesus, we must also experience the miracle of sight. Do you see God's glory? Do you see who Jesus is? Are you believing what Satan says, that God is a tyrant, that he hates you, that he stands over you ready to condemn you for the least fault? Or do you see the God who wants to abundantly provide for you exceedingly above what you could ask or think? He wants to give you victories in your life that you can't imagine could happen for you. He wants to use you and give you an influence to win others that you couldn't imagine that you could touch and reach another person's life that way. So what is Jesus trying to reveal to you about himself in your life right now? And are you looking at him with spiritual sight, or are you missing what he wants to show you? Today, are you experiencing the miracle of surrender, the miracle of sanctification, and the miracle of sight? What would keep you in a place of spiritual scarcity when Jesus has provided for you to enjoy abundance in him? What would cause you, after enjoying this wonderful service and everything it symbolizes about the wonder of Christ our Lord, what would cause us to turn around from here and go back to a place of scarcity? Today, Jesus' invitation is, come out of the scarcity. Come out of the scarcity of your shame and your condemnation and guilt. Come into the abundance of the righteousness of Jesus, which by faith in him stands in place of your unrighteousness. Come out of the scarcity of defeat and repeated failure into the abundance of abiding in Jesus moment by moment, allowing his spirit to bear fruit in your life. Come out of the scarcity of being afraid to own Jesus publicly, to the abundance of letting Jesus give you a testimony that can touch and change the life of another person who doesn't know the Lord. Can you say amen? Amen. Will you stand with me today? The Lord is inviting you to enjoy his spiritual abundance, and I believe this truth is captured in this wonderful hymn, hymn number 407. I want to sing this with you as an appeal and a response and a prayer that we're to be sent forth with God's abundance, sent forth with his blessing. You may not be familiar with the hymn, but you're very familiar with the tune once you hear it, and it'll be easy to sing along. Hymn number 407, Sent Forth by God's Blessing. I want you to remember as you exit today the deacon and deaconess's offering that is specifically used to care for the members. So that's an important offering for us to contribute to. And after we dismiss, there will be also a group gathering in the front corner of the sanctuary to pray, and you're invited to join in that as well. 10 minutes after the dismissal, there will be a prayer group, and we're having fellowship meal, and the deacon and deaconess's fund we'll be collecting an offering as you exit. Let us bow our heads today. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you that we could celebrate your supper, this rich feast. It's just a small piece of bread and a small portion of wine, but it's a great portion of grace and righteousness and love to undeserving sinners. We say thank you. May the service now continue to bear fruit in our life. We go forward to live for you, Jesus, to walk with you, to serve you, to be an example and representative of who you are to others who desperately need to see you in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. God bless, friends. Happy Sabbath.